vigilant soldier of good behavior, giving us the aptitude, very good blameless. You know, it keeps emphasizing the issue of one wife in leadership, in ministry. Now, why did he say that? Because in that culture, there are people who are polygamists in that culture. It was not a, the man has three wives and he's a member of the church. No, it was normal. It was normal culture in that time. Okay, in many places in the world, it's still cultural, it's still permissive. You know, monogamy is more of a Christian thing, in case you all don't know it. It's more of a Western, the Western culture is affected by Christianity. Sometimes people don't realize that. And people tell me, well, you from Africa, you guys have two wives. I laugh, I say, we're Christians. That means we only have one wife. Okay? Yeah, but apart from Christianity, even in the Western world, polygamy is key. People practice polygamy in America without putting a ring on a woman's finger. How do I know that? A man will have three children by three different women. What do you think he's doing? His money is going to them. He's paying child support to this one, that one, and the other one. He's a polygamist without putting a ring on their finger yet. That's really what it is. He has three homes or four homes. And many times, I'm sorry, kids, close your eyes a little bit. These men go and sleep with the women too. With the women they have children with. Because sometimes the woman says, oh, child support, oh, if you want child support, I gotta come and see you. You know what that is? I'm sorry, kids, close your ears. But those things happen. So what I'm saying, you know, Jesus came, please, if you can write this down, Jesus came to bring everything back to his original condition. Amen. That's what Christ came to do. Everything. He came to restore everything back to original condition. Okay? Man was separated from God. He came to bring man back to God. Man was separated from his wife, Adam and Eve. The woman you gave me. God, Jesus came to bring that back. A lot of things, dysfunction happened after Adam and Eve. Dysfunction, marital, where polygamy, where bestiality, where homosexuality, all those things were the result of dysfunction based on the fall of Adam and Eve. So Christ came to bring things back to their original order. That's why Christ said, he said in that same scripture, we read on that same Matthew 19, he said that Moses gave you a bill of divorcement because had messed with heart. Which means that it's not God's intention, it's not God's original plan. Every marriage will go through tough times, will go through challenges. Why? Because we're human. Yes. Are you perfect? If you're perfect, come and take over and preach our mission. All of us will kneel down and put your hand on our head. You're not perfect. Okay? Yes, ma'am, go ahead.
And some, when they get in bad marriages, they'll say that they made a mistake and, you know, it wasn't God's will for them to be married. You know, this is the excuse they'll make. Mm-hmm. But if God never intended, I feel like it would never happen.
Let's put it up. Whether God intended or not, I don't care. Once you're married, you're married. Mm-hmm. I don't care. Because the unbelievers who are not Christians, they're married. Mm-hmm. The Bible says what God has joined together, mm-hmm. let everyone put us under. Someone said, well, that means God not joined us together. Please listen to me very carefully. Marriage also is cultural. What am I cultural? What we call marriage in my culture, the way it's done might not be the way you do your marriage. Right. Now, because we are Christians, we do it in the church. Mm-hmm. Before the church became an institution, it was families. That's how it was. You find somebody in that family, you come to, you bring your family members, the man who brings his family, his uncle, and they come and say, oh, we're interested in you and your family. Oh, okay, then we set up a day, and then I say, oh, blah, blah, blah. They'll do a ceremony of some sort. That's how marriage was done before. Okay, now we are Christians, we do it in the church. So you got to understand that marriage before the church, before the institution of the church was established, the way we have formal church now, it was done, it was families. It was families. So anybody telling me that, well, God joined us together, whether God told you or God did not tell you, once you told somebody, you are my wife, I did your family way, whether you kissed or you did not kiss, whether you exchange rings, this is your wife, it's done. God says married, period. Whether you're Christian or non-Christian, now some people say, well, before I got married, I was not a Christian. Therefore, that was not the will of God. Give me a freaking break. That's a lie from Peter Hill. Go and read the Old Testament. How many times did anybody get married from a priest? Go to the Old Testament. Go and see. It was all families. It was family affair. When Abraham wanted to find a wife for his son Isaac, he sent Eliezer to go and investigate. And they went to the family. When Samson wanted a wife, he sent his father to get. That's how it was done. There was not a ceremony like they're going for a priest. And the priest says, oh, I do kiss. That's Western stuff. Before there was just family union, family covenant, family coming together. Okay, you're now your daughter, okay, fine, you're now son, okay, good. You're now married, good, you go your way. That was how it was culturally. So we need to understand that. So we don't, while I understand the issue of God told me, that's a valid thing, but there's also the place of two people have come to an agreement to live together and to be as one man and one wife. They come and make that proclamation in front of the church. Praise the Lord. Amen. I heard a minister say, well, when we got married, it was for the wrong reason. It was because I was lustful. Well, hey, the Bible says that rather than burn, marry. So that covers that minister too. Yeah. Oh, because we're young, we're very young. I was 19, she was 20. I was more, it was because of lust. Well, you are still, the Bible covers you. Rather than burning lust, marry her. You marry her because you're in lust, you're married now.
I heard a preacher say, he said one of his members who were married came to him and said, well, pastor, I need to find my soulmate, and how do I know that I have the right one? He said, well, you're married to him, so he's the right one. If you're married, that's the right one.
That's the right one.
Exactly.
Okay, let's go, turn to 3:10. The last scripture that's on the top part. I'm going to read it. It says, and you fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Okay, if you, I looked at other translations of that particular scripture. Provoking to wrath means to, it means certain things. It means don't provoke them. Don't push them to resentment. Don't make them begin to resent you. Don't be too hard on them and turn them into, and make them rebellious. I looked at different translations of that particular scripture. But it tells you, fathers, provoke not your children to wrath. Now, why did he say fathers? See, if you look at the Bible, one of this, let me say this for you when you study the Bible. When it says mothers or women or fathers, it's because God knows that there are certain characteristics that are more dominant in fathers than mothers. Amen. Fathers tend to be more harsh. You know, that's, you know, my house, if I say, hey, everybody says that. My wife says, hey. She has said like 3-4 times. I only say it once. When I say it once, that's it. In fact, sometimes when my son is leaving, I'm not home, they call me on the phone and I say, hey, on the phone. He's not seeing me. As soon as he hears my voice on the phone, he behaves himself. Yeah. My wife will say it a million times, he has not moved the package. So, but the Bible tells us that we should not provoke our children to wrath and fathers. Okay, that's for men. Also, this father also speaks of spiritual fathers. Sometimes people who are in authority, you know, headship authority, spiritual fathers, sometimes they are not very tender related to those who are under them. And sometimes that leads to rebellion. It leads to people, you know, sometimes I've heard people say, someone broke away from my church, but I stand his own. It's a rebellion. Many times I've heard people, and I said to myself, the reason why he broke away from you was because you were provoking into wrath. That's why. You were being too harsh and not being flexible and certain things. So there are some points I want us to look at. Some points I want us to look at. Let me read the thought and then we'll look at 3:1:1. I read the thought. It says that as a minister, you must meet one significant family qualification. You must rule your own house, hold and live well. The home is a miniature of the church. The home is the proven ground for leadership in the church. The husband is head of the home. This does not mean he's the tyrant or dictator or bully of the home. It means that he's a leader of the wife and children. He leads them all in the building of a loving, joyful, and peaceful home, in the fulfillment of their life's calling and task upon the earth. It means that you are not bossed about or dominated by your wife, that you will not allow your children to disobey, rebel, or talk back to you or their mother, that you take the lead in controlling your home for Christ and his kingdom. Let's go to 3:11. Note, Titus 1:6 above, as a minister, you must have faithful children. By faithful is meant believing in the Lord Jesus Christ and remaining faithful to him. The children are to be above reproach. They are not to be loose, immorals, and conduct, or unruly, or disorderly, as amplified New Testament. As a minister, note Ephesians 6:4, you and your wife must not provoke your children to wrath. Four things will provoke a child. I want us to read the four. But before that, let's kind of look at this part here. It tells us that as a minister, your children. Now, when the Bible also, there's certain words that if you study a little bit, look at the Greek and all that, you see that the word children used there does not speak of adult children. It's not adult children. It's children who are still under you, who are not emancipated, who are still under your roof. Okay? You don't have control by your children who have left your home.
Right.
And I'm not saying you should not raise them up the right way. I'm not saying you should not try to influence them. But they're adults. When a child is not under your roof anymore, when the child is independent, I don't need the one in college. Because the one in college, guess what? You're still paying their college fees. Therefore, technically, they're under you. Still, but when somebody is now emancipated, they're on their own, they're paying their own bills, they're living their own space, as it were, even if that space is under your house, okay? Sometimes you might have an apartment, you might have a split-level house, a child, an adult child lives underneath, okay? But they have their own job, they have their own space. I mean, if I were you as a parent, collect rent from them, you're still in my house, son, but you're my son, but you claim to get an adult now, bring that rent money every month. Amen. Yeah. Amen. That's important. Hallelujah. It's important. When I lived with my brother, my sister, and brother-in-law for years, I lived in their house. I didn't even live separate. I lived inside their house. They did not ask me for rent. I paid rent. They didn't ask me for it. Every month that I get paid, I come and I give them. My son said, "What's this for?" I said, "That's rent. Why you know that you stay here, my brother?" I said, "Yeah, but I'm a full-grown man. I'm earning money now. Take your money." Okay, we take it. And that was it. But that way, it helps them to be responsible. That's not enough. But the Bible is speaking about children who are unemancipated, who you have certain influence over. There's a certain influence you cannot have over a child who is not in your house. They're an adult. They live outside of the home. But once in your house, you must have them under control. You must. Like, I've known some parents who say, "Well, why is your son not in church today? He did not want to wake up." What? In my house? You didn't want to wake up? I will tear down your door. What? You're eating my food, you're drinking the water in my house, and you don't want to wake up to go to church?
Yes.
You got to be. I'll pull out your door, I'll take off your bed. You stand outside. And sleep outside, and then don't come back here until you're ready to go to church.
There you go.
Amen, Richard.
Amen.
That's right.
A lot of parents allow their children to just run over them, do whatever they want to do. And when the results now come later, they now wonder, "But what happened? I was raised in the church." Yeah, but you did not raise them. You did not. The Bible says that train a child in the way that should go.
Mm-hmm.
And when it grows, it's not going to depart from it. When we read that, we think that train is education. No. The word is train. Train. You know how a train is? A train has coaches that are attached together. A train means that you lead it in the path that you follow, like a train. You talk him like a train, coach behind you. You turn left, you turn left. You turn right, you turn right. That's what it means. You train your child the way they should go.